Well, that's called kickback. And it's when the rope is pulled from your hand when you're trying to start the engine. It's usually it's caused by a couple of things. And mostly it's timing related. So what you'll have to do, especially if you've got one of these billet flywheels installed. Now, on this build, we're running a gasoline, a race gas. So we're going to have to retard the timing a little bit. Now, the way that you normally do that is use these keys. And the only thing with using a timing key is sometimes when it kicks back, it does this to your flywheel. This is a cast iron flywheel. And so they can destroy and even bust a cast iron flywheel when they kick back like that sometimes. And if you've got a high dollar billet flywheel on there, yes, you can. A flywheel key can wring the taper out of it just like this one and ruin it. So what I do, even if I install just like this old cast iron flywheel, I lap the flywheel in and I'm going to install it without a timing key. Now, the way I'm going to do this, I'm going to put it on there. And I'm going to move it counterclockwise because I'm going to lower my timing a little bit. I'm not running this engine on methanol, so I don't really want a whole lot of timing. I just put it up there and match up the slot. I know some of you guys were thinking about that. But I just put it up there and match up where I want my timing. And, you know, I'll turn that flywheel counterclockwise a little bit and then tap it, hold it in place, and then put the nut and the fan and the nut and the cup on there. Now, this is another issue. Non-working compression release. Now, on this build, this thing's got some pretty good compression. I mean, that piston is coming up out of the hole about almost 10,000. So, yeah, this compression release is not set. So, I've got to readjust the valves. And if yours is doing that, you're going to have to readjust and make sure you at least check your exhaust valve. Now, that's the valve that your compression release is on. And you'll want to set that and make sure it's set right at 3,000. You can even make it a little tighter depending on which cam you've got. But usually if it's cold, 3,000 is about the minimum I want to adjust mine to. And the way that's done, you see it's just got a lock nut on the top. That's a 10 millimeter and the adjustment nut is 14 millimeter. Now I've got this one tight because what I'm doing, the way I'm adjusting on these is kind of opposite of the way I do on the Hemi heads. I'll make the adjustment a little tight, and then I'll start backing it off a little bit at a time, just a little bit, and then I'll check it with the feeler gauge until I get a nice smooth drag in there. And if it feels a little loose, you can tighten the adjustment nut down some, and it might snug it back down a little bit. Do you see that? Now that was that when it did that's what it will shear a key. And now here's a key sheared on a Briggs flywheel. Now those are aluminum keys, and so when they shear, they don't tear things up. And here it is again. Yeah, when it spit back through the carburetor, it kicked that engine over backwards, and that was a timing issue right there. Best way to get rid of those is, number one, you got to make sure you're running the right octane of fuel. If you don't have, now the way this engine is designed for on this build, if you guys followed along on the Predator with the flat top Wildcat piston build, that piston raises up out of the deck about 10,000ths, around 8,000ths, but you get a little piston rock in there too. But anyway, that takes up a whole lot of real estate inside that combustion chamber of that head. And the combustion chambers on these aren't actually that big anyway. So, you know, it's displacing a lot of volume there. And it makes a heck of a good compression. No more than we've done there. It makes a heck of a good compression. So this build really needs to run, you know, 100 octane race gas or aviation gas. That would be great for this. You know, I wouldn't expect it. You could probably get by with somewhere around 95. It's possible you could run some two-stroke oil mix in with your fuel to kind of heavy it up a little bit if you're having a lot of issues. Because usually there's a couple of things that causes that kickback like that. Now, you're going to have it regardless, even when you've got everything right. Every now and then, that rope is going to get pulled out of your hands. And that's just a fact of life of performance engines. When you get the timing set about right, you know, you'll get a timing kickback every now and then. But on these billet flywheels, now these come in, they're set at, if you set it at on 0 degrees, I mean, you put a timing key in there, a stock timing key, this flywheel is going to show you around 34 degrees advance, full advance. So what I've done on this one, you know, I don't want to go much over 28. Because this is not a rip-roaring race build engine. This is something that I wanted to run, you know, maybe a higher octane gasoline, and I can still ride it around on a mini bike or a cart, you know, around the yard. So what I'm doing here, I'm setting the timing back and start by grinding the taper like we've done here. We've lapped the flywheel to the taper of the crankshaft. And you've seen this before. You know, you put a little lapping compound on there, and then you turn the flywheel left and right. And actually, I'm going to try a new method. I saw on Polar Bear Ed's used it. When he lapped his flywheel in, he put it on there and lapping compound and turned it one direction. And that makes a lot of sense. You know, I think Ed's on to something there. Makes more sense that you would grind it all the way around rather than just left and right in one spot. So I'm going to try that. Thanks, Ed. Anyway, after you get all your lapping compound done, you got to clean it off. I'm just using some cheap carb cleaner here. And I'm using an oil-free rag there because we don't want any oil, any grease, or anything on that taper. No, we want a dry pressed fit when that thing tightens down onto that taper, especially because I'm not going to use a flywheel key on mine. I've ruined a couple of billet flywheels with flywheel keys, so what I do is just I'll lap that flywheel into the crank good, and then I'll set my flywheel position where I want it, and then lock it down. Yeah, that crank's lapped good. And the flywheel's lapped good. That's what you want. But you can run, if you run a flywheel key, you know, you'll have to get an offset key. Now for this gas build, with this flywheel, the SK200, it's that EC Rev billet flywheel. Now it's got 34 built in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to end up turning that thing counterclockwise about 6 degrees. And you know, you can mount a degree wheel on the crank and move it that way if you want to be that exact, but I kind of know about what a 6 degree key looks like on an offset key. So I'm going to move that about 6 degrees counterclockwise to lower the ignition timing. So I'm going to go from around 34 degrees and back it down to around 28 degrees. And that should help. And again, you know, a lot of it has to do with your fuel. If I was running methanol, I might run it on up, you know, to 36, 38 degrees and advance it. But no, this is a gas build. And I don't really want to run a methanol fuel in this because methanol's really, I love it. Don't get me wrong. Methanol's great. But, you know, it eats up your carburetors and stuff. And, It gets into your oil, and there's a lot of maintenance to it. And for a non-race application like this is, I don't really want to change the oil every time I get done riding, you know. So we're going to stick with race gas or a higher octane, you know, run some 93 octane with some boosters in it and maybe a little two cycle oil. And to get it around between 95 and 100 is what you're shooting for. And again, sometimes when you do this, if you're not using a key, it's hard to see that slot. It depends on the flywheel. Some of the flywheels are really tough to see up in there. But, you know, this is what the keys look like. And it would be great if you could find one made out of an aluminum, an offset key. But, you know, that's what this is. This Briggs here has got an aluminum offset key, and that key is sheared a little bit. But ironically, that's about the perfect setting for methanol. But now, if you could get an aluminum key like this one, I think this is from a Polaris Scrambler. But, you know, I've not verified if it would work or not. I just saw one online. But it is aluminum. So, you know, I wouldn't be afraid to put aluminum flywheel key in one. If it shears, well, so what? It's not going to hurt anything. You know, throw the key away and grab a new one. But most of these clone engines come with a steel, well, all of them come with a steel key. And that steel key will, it's bad news for your flywheel. Now this one, yeah, I've got it setting about 6 degrees retarded right there. Now there's no key in there, but I've rotated that flywheel counterclockwise a little bit. And I'm verifying, I'm looking to see, make sure it hadn't moved anywhere. Now I'm going to put my starter cup and the flywheel retaining nut on there. But you can just judge by about how much like a 6 or 7 degree key would move that flywheel. And just move the flywheel yourself without putting the key in there. As long as it's lapped, it'll hold. On the several times that I had got a violent kickback that would have sheared a flywheel key, and I did have the flywheel move some. But since there was no key there, all I had to do was to remove the flywheel, check the taper, maybe do a spot check. No. A lot of people don't like me doing that, so I'm not going to show it, but that's the way I tighten mine down, guys. I'll put an impact on one in a minute. But, yeah, you know, the manufacturers recommend just certain torque specs, so, you know, follow the manufacturer's recommendations. And that's all I've got for today, guys. Thanks for hanging out with me. We'll see you next time.